We now turn I know you have given us other mic up here. Well, turn this speaker this way somewhere. Okay. We have come to our time when we try to answer the questions that you have, wanted to answer. Now I know Sister Pope usually have questions, but she is fixing me a cup of coffee, which I don't usually get, but I've been cold all day, and I don't need a whole lot of cold to drink, though I love cold drinks. I love them, even though I get cold drinking. I just have to understand that I'm going to be cold if I drink them. And I walked away this afternoon and left my glasses on, my reading glasses on the table. And I got to get back to my eye doctor soon, because I think my cataract is taking precedent in my seeing in my one eye. But, hey, that's the price you pay to get old or to stay here. Not everybody has to pay that price, but I thank God that I still can see. Amen. I thank God that I still have the use of my faculties. You know, I speak of what I suffer, my pain, my aches, and whatever else I have, but I got to get up and keep going as much as I possibly can. I've seen too many people get down on their sick bed who just want to make it to church one more time. They just want to get to church one more time. They want to be in the service. So I'm going to thank the Lord and use my faculties as much as I can to be in the house of the Lord, because it pays me to be in the house of the Lord. And I thank God for his kindness in allowing me to come and to stand before the saints and preach, especially when I went to the doctor and he tested my leg. I'd never expected him to say what he said when he was testing my leg and sticking me, and I wasn't jumping. I was not saying, ouch. And he said, you don't feel that? I said, no, doc. He said, he looked at my wife and said, is he falling down? And she said, no, he's not falling down. He looked with amazement, and he kept sticking my leg. And thank God that I still have the use of my limbs. You know, people ask me how I'm doing, and I say, I thank the Lord I'm still on my feet. And that might sound very light, but to me, it is a great testimony that I'm still on my feet. I look at my feet sometimes and they swell. My shoes get so tight, I wonder if I can walk. But still, God has given me grace that I'm still walking. I'm still going to and fro. At this time, I'm going to open the floor to anyone that has a question that they would like to set forth, that they have in their heart or mind, and we're going to try to answer it by the scripture. Now, I had my first question this afternoon from the brother in Washington, Virginia. He called me. He said, I got a question. And then he asked me his question, and I tried to answer him according to the scripture, told me where to look and where to go to what I think would somewhat answer his question. His question was about Elijah and Elias, or it's not Elias. Elias is Elijah.
Elisha.
That's the one that was following Elijah. And when Elijah was taken up in a whirlwind, Elisha wanted to have a double portion of the power of the Spirit that was on Elijah. And it was told him that if he sees his master taken up, that he would certainly receive his request. And he followed Elijah everywhere he went. And Elijah would tell him to wait here. God is sending him to Jericho or to Jordan, and said, stay here. He said, as the Lord liveth, he would not leave him. He would not go from him. And he stayed with Elijah no matter where he went. He stayed with Elijah no matter what anyone said. He stayed with Elijah to receive the blessing in which he desired. That was found in the second chapter of Second Kings, the second chapter. That's where that was found, about Elijah and Elisha. Now I'm opening it up to the saints here at the church. Who has the first question? Deacon Johnson.
I have a question about what you just described and the ascension of Jesus Christ when he went back into
the ascension of Jesus Christ.
When he went back to, when he had appeared on earth, and then he went back, when he went back to the Father, they saw him go up in clouds, and he told them to wait, go back to Jerusalem and wait for the promise. And, I was wondering, just like Elisha asked for a double portion of Elijah's spirit. Or his power, could the same thing be, I don't know if you're stretching it, but could the same thing be analogous to when Jesus ascended and he told them to go back to Jerusalem, wait for the promise, and, well, they did receive the promise because the Holy Ghost fell. Should we not have that same power, those things that he did here on earth with the healings and so forth?
Should not we exhibit the same things that Christ did here on earth, seeing after we receive power from on high? Should we not have that same power that Christ has? Let me see if I can put this in the right orders, if I can. because this is some of the things that I have said that in Corinthians, the 12th chapter, First Corinthians, the 12th chapter. It says in the 12th verse, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. So also is Christ." Now, what do we mean by Christ? Most of us look at it as speaking of the man, Christ Jesus. Am I correct? But Christ means anointed. I tried to teach this in Bible class one night. Christ is anointed. That's what it means. I used to wonder when it said, "Many will come in that day saying, I am Christ." I think that's the 24th chapter of Matthew. If you'll go with me. In the 24th chapter of St. Matthew and the 4th verse, Jesus answered and said unto them, "Take heed that no man deceive you." Are y'all with me? "For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive," what?
Many.
"They shall say, I am Christ." He said, many would come. Now, the Bible also says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." I continue to wait to hear many saying, "I am Christ." I look for that particular situation to develop in the land. I continue to watch for it. And I did not hear a lot of people saying, "I am Christ." How many of y'all heard a lot of folks saying, "I am Christ"? You heard a lot of folks, or you heard one?
No, I heard people say, "I am anointed." So if that's what you're trying to refer to,
now I'm referring to the word
Christ.
Christ.
No. But if it means anointed, then yes.
You're right, Sister Chapman.
That's what I was just getting at when you said that. I was like, oh, that's what, because they are anointed. We're anointed.
We are looking for them to say, "I am Christ." And you have one or two people, that there's one fellow saying he's the second coming of Christ. So we do not hear a lot of people saying, "I am Christ." Mm-hmm. But what you do hear, as Sister Chapman has just pointed out, we hear a lot of people saying, I am anointed. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen?
I have the anointing. I am anointed. And see, with us looking, because we don't take time to really pay attention to what is happening, when one says, I am Christ, they are fulfilling. Oh, you just gave me the hot water. Ain't no.
Yes, sir. You want a coffee?
Ain't no coffee in there.
Yes, sir.
That's it. The show is clear to be coffee. Oh, maybe it's some. I'm looking through this, what I thought was cellophane. And it looked clear. I'm sorry. I thought it was. I was waiting for you.
How much trouble?
I was looking and it looked clear in there. Sorry about that, Sister Pope.
Yes, sir. I just
want to have
tears.
Fine.
Your face didn't say fine.
Oh, no, no, that meant fine.
Oh, okay.
It was fine. Okay. It was just warmed up at the first touch.
Oh, okay.
That's all. So many folk are waiting for someone, a lot of folks to say, I am Christ.
Right.
Whereas you hear a lot of folks saying, I am anointed. Am I correct? Well, Christ means anointed. When I start to study, I found out that there were many Christ before Jesus Christ came. They called and they were anointed. The priests were Christ, or they were anointed. In my study in finding that out, Deacon Johnson. So many shall come in my name saying, I am Christ. And I kept looking for that and wasn't finding what I was looking for. Mm-hmm. Until I came to the understanding that Christ meant, I am anointed, and you hear that what? Continuously.
Yes.
I am anointed. Now, back to 12:12, 1 Corinthians. It says, for as the body is one and has many members, and all members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. Christ is the anointed body of Christ. It is the anointed body of Christ.
Christ is the anointed body of Christ.
Meaning the church.
Christ is the anointed body of Christ. Or the anointed is the body of Christ. I just told you what Christ meant. Okay. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Now, I'm skipping over the scriptures and going to the 27th verse of the same chapter. It says, now ye are the bodies of Christ.
Body.
Ye are the body of Christ and what?
Members
in particular. If we are the body of Christ, we should have the power of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
And so, since we are the body of Christ, we have to look at it and see that we are the anointed and we are supposed to have the power that Jesus had while he was here. Has the church raised any dead? Peter raised the dead, didn't he?
Yeah.
Was he part of the church?
Yes. Yeah.
Paul raised a dead man, fell out the raft,
that's right,
broke his neck.
That's right.
Paul reached down, and the man, he healed the man. Amen.
You told us about that church that prayed their pastor back.
There's many times that things have happened. I saw, I think it was Dr. Lundy, who lost his wife at a ministerial council in Indianapolis, Indiana. It was full of ministers, and they prayed for her. But she did not return. They did not return. What's the matter? You're right, Deacon Johnson. We're supposed, the body, the church is supposed to have this power if we are the body of Christ.
That's right.
Hold on a minute. Sister Blandon had her hand up first. Pardon?
I was just going to answer the question.
Yeah, I think she was too. So okay. She had her hand up first.
One thing about it is, I think the only way you're going to do that is that you have to step out there in faith, believing God will do that. Do we have that much experience to do that? All it takes is one time. But it's like, I don't know if we're too afraid to step out there and know that God got our back, or maybe things just haven't been happening to the place where we feel like we, you know, need or are using the power that God has given us.
Amen. We have fallen in the situation that we should be in. The church is the body of Christ. Ye are the light of the world. And if, ye are the salt of the earth. Same thing as the light, but I had really had salt in my mind. I was getting ready to say if the light lost its savor, but that wouldn't have been in the right context. Ye are the salt of the earth. Now, who's he talking to that ye are the salt of the earth?
Church.
He's talking to the church. I know everybody wants to conclude themselves in the church. And we have our church, our heads of our church, have concluded that everybody is the same. I was talking to a bishop, and I was reading, he had a book by Spurgeon. And when I spoke to him, I said, as smart as this man was, because he's dead and gone. This bishop is dead and gone. So as smart as this man was, isn't it sad? He didn't know the baptism in Jesus' name. And immediately, my bishop attacked that and attacked me on it. just as saved as we are. And I stopped. I knew then to keep my mouth shut. When you go to the extent to put them on the same level as us, and we are not stepping out with the power of God, which we have. See, I remember that one of the young sisters in this church, they had something wrong with them. I forget what it was, but it was affecting their eyes. And they had gone to the doctor. And they came to, they told this woman, they came to me and said, "Elder Hope, I want you to pray for my eyes." They said, "I'm going to have an operation." I said, "Do you believe the Lord?" She said, "Yeah." But she believed in her pastor also. And I laid hands on her in Jesus' name. And she went back to the doctor. And when the doctor examined her, he could not find the same thing that they saw aforetime. And they checked her, and they came back and checked her again. And they asked her what happened between the time that they had saw her and she had to return to the hospital. She was healed. And she did not need the operation. Did I heal her? It was the power of the Holy Ghost that God had given to heal her eyes. It was God's power. And we got to understand that comes through the church. You say, "Well, other churches are healing." Oral Roberts, when I was listening to him as a young man, he used to come on television. I remember it's in black and white. Y'all remember black and white?
He'd be in the tent. He'd be in the tent.
But I watched Oral Roberts every Sunday morning. Oral Roberts began to heal. And he was healing in the name of Jesus. And I said, it was so strange to me. How is he doing that? And he hasn't said anything about the baptism in Jesus' name. Hell, I was questioning. I got to ask my father. He said, "God acknowledges his name."
All right.
See, but we have the power, the church. But when the church, when the salt has lost its savor, when the church has lost its strength, God's going to heal. His name still has power. As the church, we have the same power. I was talking to our diocesan. I was in Flint. And we were talking. I guess I really was talking too much, but it was the songs were going, and I was asking him, and he said something about the power. I said, "That's the church." I said, "The church got the power." He said, "You know, you're right. The church has the power to heal. But why doesn't it heal, Deacon Johnson? They have lost their power because they have not served God as they should, and he has withdrawn himself. We got to come back to him. He hasn't really gone away from us, but we've gone away from him. We've gone away from the source.
All right.
And that's where the salt has lost its savor. Its salt has lost its strength. When it says lost its savor, it's lost its strength. And that's a problem. So it looks like we're no more powerful than anyone else if we don't trust God as we ought to trust him. Do you understand what I'm saying? Sister Blanny.
I remember a lot of the times whenever I really think that I need the Lord and my heart is really in it because I'm going through some stuff. It's like my faith kicks in because I get to the place where I just turn it over completely to him and go on and do what I'm going to do.
Mm-hmm.
God has always worked on my behalf, which whenever he does that, it gives me to know that the more I trust in God, the more he will work on my behalf. I got to trust him more than what I do. It starts with the little things. And I can kind of like see it now, looking back over my life, stepping out there on faith whenever I had boldness. And the Lord always worked. He always made a way for me. I never had a problem trying to come to church all the time. The devil started bugging me. And I got to the place where I just got tired of it. And I just decided, well, regardless of what happens, I'm going to trust in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as I made my mind up to do so, he worked on my behalf.
Amen.
And it let me know that it is God. There is a God, you know. But what he's doing is he's not trying to rush me. He's just trying to give me a chance to really know that he is there for me.
He is there for me.
And now looking back over my life where God has truly been, and I know that he's been there, it's like, wow, I can go hither and I can go there, and I know that I'm never by myself.
Amen.
And I can always talk to
him. I can remember that you many times said, "Elder Hope, I don't know if I can make it." I said, "Well, let's put the Lord's hand. Mm-hmm. Let's pray and put in God's hand." Too many of us are afraid to put it in God's mm-hmm. hand because we might get the answer we need. Not the answer we want. We might get the answer we need. See, it is the power of God is working through the church, through Christ. He's working through Christ. He's working through the anointed. We are a peculiar people. We are different. And when we count ourselves no different than the others, our power is gone. Our power is gone. Until we come to the realization, you know, certain things I want done, I have to start asking God. Because I get frustrated. The devil knows how to frustrate you. And then I have to ask God to do it. And I have to realize I've turned it over into his hand. As soon as I can let it go, when he goes to work. Mm-hmm. But as long as I hold on to it, thinking I can figure a way to work it, it doesn't get done. As soon as I turn it loose, it begins to happen. So the power, Deacon Johnson, is the church. The church is the power of God. God is working through us. He has given us what? The ministry of what? Reconciliation. To wit, that God was where? In Christ. What's he doing? And he using us. He using us to reconcile the world. But if we become the world, how do we reconcile them? Amen?
Amen.
We can't reconcile them if we continue in the vein of doing what they do, going where they go. That is, our priorities are being with them instead of with the saints. Come on now. If we ain't going to be with the saints, how is God going to bless us? And I don't mean that you got to be walking all the time in the presence of the saints, but you ought to always be walking in the presence of the power of God and recognizing who you are. We're peculiar. We're supposed to be different. Sister Ashley.
Two questions from Facebook. First question is from Minister Bernard Gladney. Question is, why did Jesus weep at Lazarus' tomb if he knew he was going to raise him from the dead?
This is where Jesus' humanity comes into play. When we lose a friend, a brother, someone that's close to us, how do you feel?
Sad.
We cry that we've lost a friend. It shows the humanity of Christ. Then he used the power of the Holy Ghost to raise him from the dead. He loved Lazarus. But Lazarus had to go through so he could show his power. But he had to cry first. Excuse me. To show humanity. That's how great God is. That's how great God is. He is a man, fully man, and he's fully God. All at the same time. But he humbled. Isn't that what it says in Philippians, the second chapter? Let's see what it says. Philippians 2. It says in 5. It says, let this mind be in you, which was also where?
In
Christ Jesus. Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, to be the same as God. That's what it says. He thought it not equal to be the same as God. You got to be the same thing. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him what? The form of a servant. and was made in the likeness of men. So the servant he became is a man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. He humbled himself to be a man. With everything that a man goes through, God knows what it is. He knows all the emotions of a man. You can't say God don't understand what we're going through. You can't do that. Because God became a man. God himself laid down his life. 1 John 3:16. Hereby perceive we the love of God. Because he laid down his life. Ooh, God laid down his life for us. Of Revelation 1, 17. What does it say? I'll get your hand in just a minute. Revelation 1, 17. I'd like to read it. I could quote it, but it's better read. Don't make no mistakes. Go down, skip down. Let's see, am I in the right place? 17, you're right. I'm sorry. Read.
And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me. Saying unto me,
Fear not.
I am the first.
And the last.
Now wait a minute. If you're the first and the last, what come before you?
Nothing.
What's happening after you?
Nothing.
Who said this?
Jesus.
This is that one that John saw. You go back up and read. It's the one that John saw. That was Jesus. Read.
I am he that liveth.
What does liveth mean? He continues to live. He never died. He's always living. Isn't that what it means? Read.
Wait a minute.
He continues to live always. But he was dead.
Yes.
What do you call that, a conundrum? Would that be right with... Am I using that right, Deacon Johnson? You can teach it. What's a conundrum?
I don't
know. You call it God. You call it God.
Something that should not, that would not make sense. I think that's what a conundrum is, if I'm not mistaken. But he said he liveth. He always lived. And then he says what?
Was dead.
Then says what?
And behold,
I'm alive. What?
Evermore.
Who can do that?
God.
Who can do that? But God. That's the only one I know can do that. Does that answer the question, Sister Ashley? I hope.
I believe so.
Yes, ma'am.
I have two more questions.
Well, these are ones watching.
Yes. Another one from Facebook from Sister Connie Watson. What does it mean, truly mean, to be apostolic?
To truly mean to be apostolic would be to follow the apostolic doctrine as the apostles laid it out. Just like they did from the day of Pentecost forward. Believing on Christ, that is,
through their word. St. John. 17. St. John 17. We have to believe on Christ through their word. That's the only way we can make it. 17. Now, the 19th verse of the 17th verse. 17th chapter. 19th verse. Mm-hmm. What did I say?
It's okay.
Shit. That sounds like coffee has an aftertaste. It's okay while you're drinking it. But as soon as it gets cold, it has an aftertaste.
You want me to heat it up again?
Huh?
You want me to heat it up
again? No, that's all right. Don't worry about it. That's okay. I just, that's the time I don't drink a lot of coffee. It has an aftertaste. Okay, read the 19th verse.
And for their sakes,
I sanctify myself.
That they also might be sanctified.
Through the truth. Now, I can go back and start where Jesus started, but in my particular Bible, it has red lettering telling me that these are the things which Jesus is saying while he's here on earth.
Yes.
Okay? Yes. These are the things, the words of Jesus while he is here. Read.
Neither pray I for these alone. For them also.
But for them also.
Which shall believe on me. Through their word.
Who's their word? The apostles. He's talking about the apostles. The only way I can't, somebody said, I believe what Jesus said. I don't believe what Peter said. You can't believe what Jesus said and not believe Peter.
All right.
You got not one word that Jesus wrote. So if you go to Matthew, you believe it on Matthew.
Mm-hmm.
28:19. Go ye therefore teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. It said the name, not titles.
Amen.
He said in the name. Those are proper names of groups of people. But the proper noun is Jesus.
Yes.
Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
So we can't reach or do what Jesus has asked us to do except we believe the apostles. Paul wrote the most letters to the church in order to correct the church in its travel to heaven. Paul wrote the letters. Now some people think they're smarter than Paul. They think Paul is dumb. They're smarter than Peter. They're just men. But you can't make it unless you believe what they said. Because Jesus said, neither pray I for these alone,
but for them also,
which shall believe on me
through their word.
These alone are the apostles.
The apostles at that time is the church.
No, it's the word. Pray I for these alone. That's the apostles.
Neither pray I for these alone.
That's the apostles.
The apostles.
Okay.
The disciples. All of the disciples that were following them, because there were many that went out, but there were 12 apostles.
That's right. Okay.
But neither pray I for these alone, but for all them that believe on me through their word. Only way to make it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you study as what's that man's name? That book I got.
Eusebius.
What's your name?
Eusebius.
No, not Eusebius.
Arnold?
No, it's one that wrote back in 200s. Proof of the Gospel. That's the name of the book. He wrote it back in the 200s. And he wrote that Jesus said, make disciples in my name. In Matthew 28, 19. That's what I studied and found. Nike or something. Can't think of his name. But the man said, 28, 19 said, and he said, go make disciples in my name.
Yes.
But the Trinitarians got it and thought to change it and said, baptize them, say Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
All right.
That's not what it said. What? No. That's not what Jesus said. Let's go to Luke 24:46. Luke 24:46. Let's see what Luke said he said.
And said unto them,
Thus it is written.
And thus it behooves Christ
to suffer.
And to rise from the dead.
What?
The third day.
He got up on the third day. Come on.
And that repentance.
And remission of sins.
Should be preached
in Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
In his name.
Not in his titles.
All right.
Now, are the apostles disagreeing?
No.
Because Matthew, as they put it, wrote, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Well, what's the Father's name?
Jesus.
Matthew 1. Excuse me. Not Matthew. John 5. 43. St. John. 5:43.
I am come.
You got it? I am come.
In my Father's name.
In my Father's name. Now, that's what Jesus says in St. John 5:43. I am come in my Father's name. Well, what name did he come in?
Jesus.
Matthew 1. 18.
Now the birth of Jesus Christ.
See, y'all know too much.
Now the birth of Jesus Christ. Was on this wise.
When as his mother Mary.
Was espoused to Joseph. Before they came together. She was found with child. Of the Holy Ghost.
I thought God was his father.
Yes.
That's right.
But they said God was his father. Mm-hmm. And they said the Holy Ghost is the third person. They said that the Holy Ghost is the third person in the Godhead. That's what the world believes.
That's right.
And we as apostolics are lending truth to it.
Yes.
by saying it's the same thing. What did you say that again?
Now
the birth of Jesus Christ
was
on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together,
she was found with
child of the Holy Ghost. Read.
Then Joseph, her
husband,
being
a just man,
and
not willing to make her a public what?
Example.
Was minded to put her away. Read.
But while he thought on these things,
behold,
the angel of the Lord
appeared unto him in a dream,
saying, Joseph,
thou son of David,
fear not to take unto thee
Mary thy wife,
for that which is conceived in her
is of the Holy Ghost.
And she shall bring forth a son.
Call his name Jesus. And who gonna call him that?
Thou.
Who is thou?
Joseph.
Told Joseph. Thou shalt call his name what?
Jesus.
He shall save his people. For he shall save his people
from their sins.
Now, why would the Lord change it in the 28th chapter? Why would they change it? Why would he change it in the 28th verse? I mean, 28th chapter. He wouldn't. And he didn't.
All right. Come on now.
Acts 4:12. For neither is there salvation
in
any other. For there is none other name
under heaven
given among men,
whereby we must be saved.
Come on now. Like Sister Ashley's getting a lot of questions. Skype? Is that what it
is? These two were texted to me.
Pardon?
These two were sent to me through text.
I mean, they must be looking at it, though.
One is on Facebook. They're on now. Some have been on Facebook, and others are texting me.
Some on Facebook and stuff. That's good. What is it?
Okay, next question. In Genesis, was Satan cast out of heaven between verses 1 and 2 of the first book of Genesis?
That's what is believed, because in the first, read the first verse of Genesis.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
Now, when God, if you read on, God, everything he made, he said that's good.
Mm-hmm.
But now, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Second verse.
And the earth was without form. And void.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters.
Now see, what is believed at this particular time is that there was a great war, because he kicked Satan out of heaven. That's what it says in Isaiah, the 14th chapter.
Would that be considered the Big Bang Theory?
No.
Stop it.
Unless Satan, when he hit, he had a Big Bang.
Yeah.
But then.
Now I can consider that one.
No, Big Bang. They said before anything happened, there was a Big Bang Theory.
That's a theory.
Excuse me.
I mean, if there was a war, it just big bangs.
The only bang was when the Lord kicked him out. Mm-hmm. I said kicked him out. That was it. I'm gonna leave that alone.
All right.
But in 14:12 of Isaiah.
How art thou fallen
from heaven,
O Lucifer?
O Lucifer,
son of the morning.
Son of the morning.
How art thou cut down to
The ground?
Which didst weaken the nations.
For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven.
I will exalt my throne
above the stars of God.
I will sit also
upon the mount of the congregation
in the sides of the north.
I will ascend above the heights of the clouds.
I will be like the Most High.
He boasted. Read.
Yet thou shalt be brought down
to hell.
To the sides of the pit.
To the sides of the pit.
They that see thee
shall narrowly look upon thee.
And consider thee.
Saying.
Is this the man?
See, God is so great that Satan is no more than a man. That's the way God sees it. God is so great that he sees Satan no more than a man. And when we see him, it says, they that see him, that is, when we see him, when the people of the earth see Satan, when they look on this man, y'all heard of the Wizard of Oz. I think this is where they got the story. It said, they that see him shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee,
saying,
is this the man that made the earth to tremble
and did shake the kingdoms,
that made the world
as a wilderness
and destroyed the cities thereof,
and opened not the house
of his prisoners. Now, we're going to narrowly look on it and say, is this the man? Is this what we've been scared of? Is this who we've been running from? But in Revelation, it calls him a dragon. That is, he got a spirit of a dragon. When he tossed out of heaven and he drug many of the angels with him. I ain't got time to go into that all tonight.
Last question. Did Moses see the back parts of Jesus in Exodus 33 and 23?
Exodus what?
33 and 23, excuse me.
33 and 23. Whoever's asked that, is it 33?
Oh, the last two questions were 33 and 23.
33 and 23.
Yes, the last two questions were posed by Minister Jakar Amory.
Who's that?
Jakar Amory. Deacon Whitby's great nephew.
Pardon?
Deacon Whitby's great nephew.
Oh, okay.
He preached here before.
Everything don't matter. And I will take away my hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. In other words, it was Jesus. Jesus did not come into existence in Bethlehem of Judea. Mm-hmm. He was born in Bethlehem, Judea. Mm-hmm. But he was God in the beginning.
Right.
He was God in the beginning. That was Jesus that Jacob wrestled with all night long. Mm-hmm.
That's why I said Jesus. That's why I said his name is a secret.
Mm-hmm. That was God. Who had appeared in a body.
Mm-hmm.
Abraham, in the 18th chapter of Genesis, saw God walking down the road with two angels.
Mm-hmm. All right. You tell us that was a theophany. All right.
That's what you call a theophany. He just appeared. He wasn't born. Mm-hmm. And one was the Lord, or one was Jesus.
All right.
Jesus has been here Since.
Amen.
If you got my drift. Oh, Sister Pope, did you hear you?
Don't
oh, Sister Pope did.
No. Okay. In this verse, 33:23, it says, and thou shalt see my back parts.
Mm-hmm. That's his flesh.
Okay.
That's just his flesh. That's all.
But thou shalt not see my power. But my face shall not be seen.
That to me, you'll see my flesh. But you ain't going to see all of my power.
Well, it does say that my glory passeth by in 22.
You wouldn't be understanding what we are the whole.
Yeah, well, that's what he's saying. My glory passeth by.
And Jesus is his glory. His glory is his power.
Yes.
Just like his grace is his power.
Mm-hmm.
His grace is not unmerited favor. His grace is the power of God to save. And his grace to save is through his blood.
Yes, sir.
Through the baptism in Jesus' name. Yes. Anybody ain't baptized in Jesus' name is lost.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, I said it.
Oh, good.
Any more questions? Y'all finished? No more questions, Deacon John?
Just a moment. Had a hand up.
Sister Dokie, get your hand up.
Yes, sir. This same verse 23, does that go along with the verse I think in St. John said, no man has seen God at any time?
What is that verse at?
Isn't it in St. John?
Let's see. Is that the fifth chapter?
No, it's 1:18. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him.
No man, as St. John 1.
1:18.
Let me turn that so I can get that right quick. I guess y'all got to go home pretty soon. Y'all tired, ain't you?
You're going to have another.
That's one what?
1:18.
It says,
No man
has seen God
at any time.
The only begotten Son,
which is in the bosom of the Father.
Which is in the bosom of the Father.
He hath declared him.
He hath declared him.
Yes.
No.
Okay, speak, Lord.
Jesus. Help me, Lord. In St. John 5:37,
and the Father himself,
read the 36th verse.
But I have greater witness.
I have greater witness
than that of John.
Than that of John.
For the works which the Father.
For the works which the Father
have given me.
To finish
the same works that I do.
The same works that I do.
Bear witness of me.
That the Father
hath
sent me.
And the Father himself.
Which
hath sent me.
Hath borne witness of me. Ye have neither heard his voice.
At any time.
Nor seen his shape. Read. And ye have not his word abiding in you.
For whom he hath sent.
Him ye believe not. Y'all understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Huh?
Yeah. I don't, because in Exodus, it said his song.
They had to believe.
You had
they
to
believe.
If you don't believe him, you don't see him.
That's why he said nobody saw him.
Because if you read the rest of it, it's because they did not believe.
Okay, but Moses did see him.
Because he believed.
Okay, but how do you say that nobody has seen him at any time?
Did you believe him when he came?
No, but Moses believed that he saw him. So how can you not see him?
Part.
It's like he's never been seen, but he was seen because Moses saw him.
That part.
Yes.
He saw the back part.
No man sees him because they don't believe him. The only ones that see him are the ones that believe him. No man that doesn't believe sees him. No man that does not believe sees him. You got to believe him to see him.
All right.
Amen.
Amen.
14 John.
No question. I got two sheets of paper.
14 John.
Start with.
Fifth verse.
Thomas saith unto him, Lord,
we know not whither thou goest.
How can we know the way?
Jesus saith unto him,
I am the way.
The truth.
And the life.
No man cometh unto the Father.
But by me.
Read.
If ye had known me. Ye should have known my Father also. From henceforth ye know him. And have seen him.
Wait a minute.
All right.
Many of you all see me, know me, but have never seen my Father. So he couldn't have been talking the way any other man talked. He said, what? If ye had known me,
you should have known my Father
You should have known my father also.
From henceforth,
ye know him.
And have seen him.
But why did Philip say, show us the Father? Wait a minute. Let's go back. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Yes, sir.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Who is the Father?
The Holy Ghost.
God.
The Holy Ghost. So God and the Holy Ghost is what?
Same person.
St. John 4:24.
God is a spirit.
God is a spirit.
What was that, St. John?
4:24.
God is a spirit. So you can't see a spirit. And the spirit is the Holy Ghost. And the spirit is the Father.
Yes, sir. All right. St. John 10:30 says, I and my Father are one.
Come on now.
Y'all won't let me do it.
You said we're supposed to know where you're going.
It says, now where was I at? 14. Now it says, Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Mm-hmm. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Mm-hmm. And the Father is a spirit.
Yes, sir.
And you can't see a spirit. But Jesus says, if you had known me,
yes.
See, you can't see the spirit till he puts on flesh.
Mm-hmm.
If he had known me, you should have known my Father also.
Mm-hmm. And from henceforth.
And from henceforth.
You know him.
You know him.
And have seen him.
And have seen him. Wait a minute. What more explanation do you need? What did he just say? When you see me,
you see the Father. You know him and you've seen him.
You know him and you've seen him. What did Philip say?
Philip said unto him,
Lord,
show us the Father.
What did he just get through doing?
Showing
him. He just showed Philip the Father. Told Philip who the Father was.
Is.
Philip said unto him, Lord,
show us the Father.
And it sufficeth us.
Jesus saith unto him,
have I been so long time with you? Wait a minute. Who did Philip want to see?
Father.
He says, have I been so long time with you?
And yet,
hast thou not known me, Philip?
He that hath seen me.
Have seen the Father.
And how sayest thou,
How sayest thou this?
Show us the Father.
Philip didn't believe it, but he was looking at it, so he couldn't see him.
All right.
Wow. Philip looking at him.
That's right.
But can't see the Father.
Come on.
Mm.
Wow.
That's deep.
He couldn't see who he was.
That's right.
Hebrews 14, I think it is. Is it 14? Or is it 3:14? What is it?
We are made partakers of Christ
3:14. Excuse me. 3:14.
For we are made partakers of Christ.
2:14.
For as much then. As the children are partakers.
As the children are partakers.
Of flesh and blood.
Of flesh and blood.
He also himself.
Wait a minute. For as much then. Watch it carefully. For as much then.
As the children. Are partakers of flesh and blood. He also himself.
Likewise.
Took part of the same.
Who did?
Jesus.
Well, let's see who we're talking about. 13th verse.
And again. I will put my trust in him. And again.
Behold, I.
And the children.
Which God has given me.
For as much then. As the children.
For now, who are we talking about? God, right?
Yeah.
For as much then as the children.
Are partakers.
Of flesh and blood.
He also himself.
Likewise.
Took part of the same. Through death. He might destroy him. That had the power of death. That is the devil. All right, read on. And delivered them.
Who through fear of death.
Were all their lifetime. Subject to bondage. For verily.
He took not on him.
The nature of angels.
Wait a minute. He didn't take on him the nature of an angel. He didn't become an angel. He was higher than an angel.
Yes, sir.
He took on the nature of a servant.
Yes, hallelujah.
And it wasn't an angel.
That's right.
Who is a servant?
Yes, sir.
You know what he said?
Yeah.
Read.
But he took on him.
The seed of Abraham. That's a man.
That's
right. So if he did not take, he took the seed of a servant, but it wasn't an angel. So God took on the seed of Abraham, which is flesh.
Right.
81 of them.
Oh, yeah.
Did I answer your question?
No.
I ain't answer all yours. That's what she's saying. Anybody else with a question?
We'll be here all night.
Huh?
We'll be here all night.
I'm free. We thank God for his word.
Yes, we do.
It's a good thing we don't have to go and pay for everything God gives us, isn't it?
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Because you can't pay for this.
That's right.
And you ain't going to even try.
Well, we can try to tip you.
Try to tip God.
Amen.
All right. Ain't he wonderful?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yes.
We have no more questions? I hope y'all enjoyed the Bible class.
Amen.
Well, I like it when the saints got questions. Like I said, young man from, as I was going to pick up Sister Ashley from work, he called me, Pastor Hope, I got a question.
and he got to talking about Elijah and Elias. Is Elijah and
Elisha.
Elisha.
And Elisha.
Elijah and Elisha.
Elijah, Elijah and Elisha. But they tell me he's reading.
That's right.
I told him what to read. I don't guarantee, but I believe he's going to do exactly what I told him to do. He's going to Revelation. Where did I send him in Revelation? About Elijah.
Elijah, Revelation?
Mm-hmm. Nobody figured it out. I want you to go home and try to find out.
Okay.
Where would I have sent him to read in Revelation about Elijah?
It'll be somewhere in the 20s.
And Moses.
The two men.
What?
About the two men in the street.
Made in three. Laid in the city. In the three. Laid in the street.
Mm-hmm.
But what?
No, that's in Matthew.
No, but it's going to be two that's in the street.
That's in Revelation.
Yeah,
that's what. No, the transfiguration is in
Matthew.
Where's it at? Where's it at?
In the Bible.
Where's it at? In the Bible.
In Revelation, in the Bible.
Where about in Revelation, in the Bible? Keep on, I'll keep going.
No, stop.
We thank God. I appreciate it. You're testing me out. See if I know anything. I see folks have been checking on me, see if they can find something wrong with it. Try to find something better than me. Ain't God good?
Amen.
You can always find something better than me. Sister Hope got the best of me.
Thank you, Jesus.
Trying to find, you try to find the better of Jesus. Any wonderful.
Amen.
We thank God for his word. Now, if y'all was in the movies, the movie would just be getting started. Lord have mercy. One of those lions off awesome yesterday.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. They barely won, but they won.
They won.
They were losing.
They were losing until I got home. And when I got home, they started winning.
I'm glad you went home.
When I got home, they got the winning.
They was winning in the first quarter.
But they quit losing. I mean, quit winning till I got home. They were only winning by three if they were winning in the first quarter. But when I got home, they were behind about 17 points. And then they recognized that I was watching. My next door neighbor, when I got home, he was cleaning his yard up. And it looked like he was cleaning his yard because he was frustrated. So I went out to dinner. I came back.
Hey, Rick. You go in now. They won. He said they won. I said, I figured you was out here cleaning up on Sunday. Because you were frustrated. Y'all want to hear some more about the lion? Sister Ashley.
One question just came in. Are you still taking questions?
I'll take it. What is it?
What's your stance on confessions? Some pastors believe you can go to God yourself and tell him your sins and ask for forgiveness, while others say you must confess them and they plead on your behalf.
You can go to the Lord and you confess your fault. You should also go to the pastor, if you can trust him. And talk to him about your weakness, that he might pray for you, that you be delivered from your situation. But you can confess your faults to the Lord, but tell it to the pastor so that he can pray for you. And hopefully he has enough contact that God will forgive you. But you believe and you do what you're supposed to do. God will take care of the rest. Amen?
Amen.
I thank God for each and every one. We're going to ask the deacons to prepare to receive offering at this time. To receive offering. Sister Hope, you have the checks for the council. I'm going to need you to write a check for the council, for myself, for